So today, I am very honored and I'm very, very glad because we have done two services already. This is our third service to introduce to you our special speaker for the morning. Can you please welcome Dr. David Hernandez on stage? Come on, brother, come and join me. David, it's been a long morning, brother, and I know it's been a long weekend because I know that you're not like me. You have a real job. I only work on Sundays. Like, seriously, kids come to me and say, so what do you do? And I'm like, but I'm 44 and I'm trying to figure that one out. What do I do? I don't know what I do. David, tell us what you do, brother, because what you do is very, very, very specific. Tell us about yourself a little bit, but specifically tell us about who you brought with you. I want to hear about that.
Good morning. God bless you. It's a great honor and privilege to be with you here. And thank you for the invitation. And I brought my bride, my wife for 27 years, Juana.
She's Come on, guys. Give him a big round of applause and welcome. Welcome the lady with us. Yes. Awesome.
So I'm here to serve. And I thank you, Yoli, and the group that put that together. That was really nice. And that's special. I feel honored that you invited my wife and I to be part of that. And just a little bit about me. I'm a, you know, pastor, you have a job. It's a job that I couldn't do. God didn't make me to be a pastor. And it's a tough job. And the Lord's opened doors internationally to go serve pastors. But how did it all start? It is, I don't make commitments. But when I do, I give 100%. And that's one thing I've learned about God. God doesn't play. He says, you serious? I'm serious. And I love that. And once the Lord started changing me, my wife, our marriage was rocky at the beginning. And so I started getting into the Word. The pastors asked me to teach and preach because nobody could read at our church. And so I started using my wife's Bible, and she would highlight certain passages, so I figured that must be important. So that's what I started learning and preaching and teaching. And one thing left to another, we became youth pastors, then we teach Sunday school teachers and going around, moving around the country. I was Air Force. Then after Air Force, I went back to the university to teach. And then I just end up here in the valley. God ordained it. I don't know how it happened, but we're here. I've been here for about 10 years. My pastor invited me to go to Europe to train pastors, and I started training pastors. I really liked that. One thing left to another, end up in Africa teaching doctors surgery. All the patients that I was operating were pastors' wives. So then that led to doing pastor conferences, training doctors and professionals around the world. And I'll tell you one thing, it hasn't been easy, this walk with the Lord, but it's been exciting. It's been exciting, never a dull moment. And I commend Yoli, because I understand what that is. When you give your all to God, you're exhausted when you hit the bed, but man, you know you accomplished the will of God for that day.
That's awesome, that's awesome. Three kids?
Three kids. Our oldest, we adopted. She was our niece. We took her in when she was seven. And she lives in Manhattan, New York. Then my second is Mariah. She's getting her master's in public health. And my son, who's the baby, Elijah, 22, and he is in seminary at Dallas Theological Seminary.
Awesome. So God has been good to you guys.
Amen.
God has been good to you. So again, you may be sitting in this place this morning and you come and join a worship service where obviously we approach places like this with multiple reasons, multiple experiences that we come from. So the question now comes, because this is one of the questions that was texted yesterday regarding relationships and marriage. And I want us to just approach this, because what happens when things don't work out? You're giving us your journey of 27 years of marriage, three beautiful young adults now. Your youngest is 22. But what happens when you, as a Christian, go through, when you experience something that has to do with divorce? So the first question, here's a question. What happens when a person gets a divorce? And when that happens, is it possible to remarry without the repercussions or consequences?
That question comes up a lot. I believe that when God saves, regardless of what we've done, what we've, because that's God's grace. God is not like us, thank God. I've seen many marriages fall apart and then remarried and God restores. Salvation is reached. Salvation comes. One of the things that's very difficult for many people to understand, and there's always consequences. You cannot avoid and get away from consequences. That's why our decisions that we make today will have an effect for tomorrow. So what happens a lot of times, if there was children in the marriage, and now they're into a different marriage, the dynamics that occurs, the consequences. Also, I tell people, like if I've met many drug addicts, heroin addicts, and they contracted HIV or hepatitis. The Lord restores them, the Lord saves them, they change their life. They come and they start preaching, teaching, serving the Lord faithful, but they still have HIV, they still have hepatitis. Individuals that with cancer, they undergo surgery, they undergo the radiation, the chemo. They may be in remission from the cancer, but the scars are still there. The residue from the radiation and the chemo is still there. Also for young people, that if you make these wrong decisions and you engage in activities that we shouldn't be in, a child is born, then the repercussions from that. So we always have to keep in mind, God is faithful, He will restore, but there are consequences in every decision, good and bad, what we make, we do.
So in this case, obviously, we're focusing on simply understanding that there will be some results of our decision making. So every decision that we make is literally creating the stories that we're going to tell tomorrow, yes, to a certain degree. So that's a reality for many of us, and no one is immune of these things. One of the questions that was brought also, David, and this is an important one, has to do with the display of affection publicly. How much do we do this? And I didn't ask you this on the first two services, but I'm going to ask you to do it this service because I remember now. See, that's what you rehearsed for two times, and then the third one, you get it. I need you to share the story that you shared last night of the lady that has surgery, and then that she was, when the husband was about to visit her, come on, I don't want to give the story away. Just please make the connection, because that was powerful.
Romance and all this stuff that we're bombarded with from the media, the movies, and everything, forget about it. I was sharing last night about a story. There was a lady, eloquent lady, 67 years old, came to my office. I examined her, and lo and behold, I'm thinking ovarian cancer. And so she goes, I was going to send her MD Anderson. She goes, no, I want you to do the surgery. I want to be here, and I want you to do it. And I went over it with her, so finally, we went forward with the surgery. She had cancer all over her pelvis and her abdomen. We tried to resect it, couldn't get it all out. Post-op day one, she's got her lipstick on, her hair made, she's all fixed up, and she's sitting up in bed smiling. And I'm like, where are we going all dolled up? And she goes, my husband's going to come to see me. And the way she spoke about him, the way her eyes lit up, I was like going, I got to stay and see who this guy is. And I'm sitting down, you know, killing time because I'm waiting, you know. Yeah, I'm busy. My beeper's going, my phone's going off, but I got to see this. So I'm waiting for Russell Crowe to come through the doors, right? On a wheelchair, I see this man being pushed in, crouched down, drooling. And she looked at him like he was her knight in shining armor. This is romance. And then when I saw them, she was playing footsies with them. And I was like, wow, that is what romance is. When I see couples that are 60, 70, 80 years old at Dairy Queen's, you know, kind of holding each other up, eating an ice cream, and one cleans the other like that, that is romance. In the hospital, when one is sick and the other one is there helping and supporting, that is romance. And if you're, that is good. Do that. Do it in unity. Do it. My wife is very modest. I can hold her hand. Maybe give her a little kiss, but that's about it. Because she's modest. I have to respect that. So once you're in a core, but the beauty about marriage is that God blesses marriage. And behind closed doors, lock the door. Adios, kids. God bless you.
I guess that's a different definition of public, you know, display and affection, what you just gave us with that story, because typically, I mean, Never mind. You guys get the point. You guys get the point. All right, here we go. Let's talk about this for a moment. This was the introduction of your talk last night. And again, you're gonna get a little bit of a, you know, of what you got saw last night in the movie. Except today there's no popcorn because there's no dinner. Last night it was a very good dinner, but tonight, today, just help us understand and elaborate on the concept of relationships where the will and the mind, you know, and the emotions come together.
This is the dynamics, the will, the mind, and the emotions. Now, emotions are very real, but you can't trust them. One day you're sad, the next day you're happy. They come and they go, they're transient. So they're real, but you can't trust them. You'll hear many people say, I don't feel it anymore. Well, you know what? That has nothing to do with marriage. Once your mind is, I'm committed to that woman, and you listen to your vows through riches, through poverty, through health, through sickness, through the good, the bad, the ugly, until death do us part. There's nothing about emotions said here. It's that you commit 100% until death do us part. There's times, you know, your pastor, I don't know if you know this, I see him at the gym all the time. And I commend him. You know what? I've been working out for about 40 years. And there's not one day I've ever gone to the gym feeling like it. Nothing. Never. But I do it. And that's the thing is emotions, but the will, the mind, I know it's good for me. The will, I know it's good. Emotions may help, may not help. And you can't depend on your emotions. It's the will. You know what's right. You know what's wrong. The will. And all together is part of marriage.
And yet, at the same time, as you think about emotions, because as you said it, they're so powerful. I mean, they're real. Mm-hmm. So we're not going to live in denial. And, we're broken vessels. The tragedy for many of us, and we talk about this in the past, is that we are in a time and age and culture that people are saying, if you feel it, you have to do it. Mm-hmm. If you sense it, you have to execute it. And in this case, obviously, we bring not only just the mind, but in this case, the mind of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Okay, let's move on to the next thing. This was a section that it was very, very helpful yesterday, describing what the Bible teaches as the spouse, as a suitable helper. Yep. Talk to us.
Adam was working really hard, okay? Adam was working in the garden. He was following instructions. God gave him orders, and he's carrying it out. He's naming the animals, busy, busy, busy working. Some of the problems that we get into is because we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing. But when God saw Adam working, he said, he needs a helper. And woman came into play. Now this word helper is powerful. Because you read the Psalms, God is our helper. It doesn't mean she's below, or you can step, or you can use, or she serves you. You're one. You become one. It's your helper. The way it works in my marriage is my wife is so many times has prevented me from putting my big foot in my mouth. Gently, she says, honey, I wouldn't say that. There's many times that I've been through some difficult times and she's praying for me. And she calls me up and she says, I love you, gives me a word of encouragement. In my practice, you know, I'm a obstetrician gynecologist, so I pay attention to medicine, you know, health care, and I do what's right and this and that, but I'm not sensitive to the female touch. My wife comes in the office, puts some flowers here, puts a picture over there, soft music, and the patients love it. I don't think that way, but she's my helper. My patients love it, and business has gone up. This is what happens. This is what we call about your helper. It's that part that you're lacking and together. So you're equal in value, but different in function. And that's very important to understand.
So equal in value, different in function. Some of you need to write that one down. It's important. Equal in value, different in function. That's definitely important for us. Okay, so in this concept of relationships, you brought the concept or the understanding of covenantal relationships. I am of the mind that this is a foreign language to our culture, mm-hmm. Covenants. So help us understand, what does that mean from a biblical perspective when a relationship functions in the context of covenants?
The word covenant is the maximum love, the essence of love, and legality, commitment, in that God makes covenants with his people, Abraham. Regardless of what Abraham did, regardless of what the Hebrew people did, the Israelites, disobedient, idol worshipers, whatever, God's covenant, his promise, his commitment. And this is what marriage is. That if you love me or not, I'm still going to love you. If I feel loving, I'm still going to be loving. If I don't feel tendering, I'm still going to be tendering. If you lie to me, I'm not going to lie to you. If you treat me bad, I'm not going to treat you bad. This is the power of covenant. And this is what marriage is all about. It's the essence. It's the most intimate maximum of love. And then the legality. You say, well, gee, Doc, that sounds kind of not romantic. That's the maximum. Because my wife doesn't have to worry that I'm going to run off with all the money and it's with somebody else because I'm binding, I'm committed to her. All that is mine is all that's hers. That is the beauty of covenant. And she has nothing to worry about because my 100% is all towards her. And then I married her to serve, to love, to cherish her. And because I'm doing that, the way God ordained it to be, it's going to be reciprocal. We're a self-centered culture today. Me, 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 me. And just with that attitude, you get one person saying me, 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 another person saying me, 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 and there's zero outcome.
Well, and I guess part of this me-ism that is obviously ingrained in us, we don't have to teach anyone to be selfish, right? I mean, you begin with little kids and you can see it all over the place. So one thing that I would like for us to just kind of build into this conversation of covenantal relationships, because you brought the person of God as a prime example of this legal binding, legal relationship that I am with you, Abraham, I'm with you, David, mm-hmm. I'm with you. You know, you go through the major pillars of the scriptures, and this love of God that the Old Testament portrays as the God who pursues the people. Now, I want to say something about this, because I think this is huge for us as a church, as a generation. The covenantal love of God that you're describing, yes, unconditional, yes, permanent, yes, there's nothing we can do. God will continue to love us. But it's exactly the same love and the same covenant that eventually brings the discipline and eventually brings the, and I have to use the word, wrath, the vengeance of God that he brings to his people for their own sake. So translate that into the relationships. When you talk about the covenantal relationship between you and Juanita as husband and wife, part of this covenant that you have with her implies that you, and the same thing applies for her, you guys will not tolerate any destructive behavior. Right. And I'm bringing it up to us in this regard because many of us, we confuse unconditional love with unconditional relationships. I love my kids deeply, but out of this love, I will not allow them to do things that will harm them mm-hmm. or will harm me. So is everybody tracking on this? It's kind of a both end that I love them so much that I will not tolerate. So for many of us, when it comes to relationships, whether it's parental or marital relationships, we have made the mistake to translate the word covenant into permissiveness. Mm-hmm. See, God was no fool. Is no fool. You won't play with God. Mm-hmm. He loves us, but he will not. See, that connects to the first question that has to do with consequences. Mm-hmm. Juanita brought the issue of Dr. Kevin Lehman mm-hmm. as one of the leading psychologists and family therapists, and he has a book called Making Your Child's Mind Without Losing Yours. And on that book, he teaches the concept of reality discipline. That our job is to teach our kids the reality of life. So keep that in mind with this word covenantal, because it is so misunderstood in so many phrases. Okay, here we go. Ephesians. That was something that we needed to talk about today also, David, because the concept of submission, kind of relating to the covenantal relationship. How does that work?
And when the man lines up under God, that woman well, and that family marches in sync. And that's a beautiful thing, because the hard times come, and you're reassured in the promises of God. You're saturated in the Word of God. And I'll tell you, and as Scripture Paul teaches us, he said, women, submit yourselves to husbands. Now that's an awful word. I remember when I was doing this lesson the first time, my wife was like, you know, like, because in our culture, that's kind of like, you know, taboo. You don't do that. You know, I'm a woman. I tell the story of my wife when I first met her. She's like, no man gonna tell, you know, that head bobbing. And I'm like, and what it means is in that culture, when Paul was teaching, women had no rights. A woman could be stoned. A woman could be thrown out. No questions asked. Okay, a woman couldn't get a divorce. A woman couldn't tell a man what to do. She had no rights. So when Paul's teaching that, women, submit yourselves to your husbands, okay, that was like, we do that anyways. But what was radical is when Jesus said, love your wives as Jesus loved the church. Now that was radical. So ladies, wives, be at ease. Because the responsibility that Christ gives us is far more than what he gave you. You submit. We have to love you like Jesus loved the church. And if you've been in church a while, you know there's some problems. But Jesus still
not in this one.
Amen.
All right, so we got to finish our time. It's been an amazing weekend, brother. Thank you for being here. But I got a couple more to go before I let you go. And this one was crucial for us. It was crucial for me to listen to your teaching last night. Two types of marriage problems, okay? Man, that was a good point that you made last night. Talk to us. What does it mean by perpetual type of problems and solvable problems?
Every type of marriage problem can be put into one or two categories, solvable or perpetual. Unfortunately, the solvable problems is about 20-30% of marriage problems. These types of problems have resolution. They have a solution. You got a couple, the husband jumped, they got one car, they both got to go to work, right? So the husband jumps in the car, he's beep, 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 beep. The wife is frantic. She's frazzled, but she's trying to clean up, wash dishes. She doesn't want to come home to a house that's messy. He's beeping, beeping, beeping. She gets in the car, her hairs are standing up, and all the way back to work. So that sets your day. Now, you think there's any romance at night? Nope. So the solution is get up earlier. Husbands, help your wives, and watch how that smooths out. There's solutions to it. Another one is when a baby comes into a family. New baby, right? That mother, she just changes her whole posture towards that baby. And she's taking care of that baby, and the husband wants to come, and he puts the diaper on wrong, and something slips out, and she gets frazzled, and she's like, ah! And he's like going, well, you do it. Well, see, just because you had a baby doesn't make you an expert, you see? So working together, you see, he's trying to help you. Maybe show him how to put the diaper on. I can deliver babies, I can get them out in C-sections, but I didn't know how to put a diaper on in the beginning. My wife showed me the correct way, you see? Those are solvable. Perpetual problems, on the other hand, there has really no solutions. I use the analogy where I have herniated discs. There's certain activities and exercise I don't do because it'll aggravate my spine, and I'll be in pain. I'll get spasms. I can't, you know, I'm doing surgery. There's certain positions I can't go into because that'll aggravate. Same thing with these perpetual problems. There's really no solution. And these are the ones that you put your spurs in the ground and you're always fighting the hostility, and the emotions are thriving. And that's when husbands, you sleep on the couch. I remember my wife and I, we started talking about family, you know. You know, and my wife was like, and it was like, it was a very touchy subject. And what we realized when the light turned on, her family was dysfunctional, my family was dysfunctional. Why? We're not going to change them. Why are we going to let that interfere with our marriage? And we've been so much more happier, and I haven't slept on the couch in years. So these are the types of two problems that marriages fall into. And you know, you see it with, you didn't go to school when you were young, you get married, then you're like, okay, finance, and then you want to go to school or change careers, and you see all the problems that can occur. But you got to ask yourself, is this solvable or is this perpetual? Because if you're trying to solve a problem that's perpetual, it'll just eat up your marriage like a cancer.
So in this case, perpetual problems, if solvable were 20% of the problems, then by default, perpetual are gonna be 80% approximately.
Yes. And that, and the issues are family. That's a big one. Finance, child rearing, careers, professions, etc. These are things that, you know, there's reasons why a husband's got to work a job and a half and the wife's got to work a job. It's because debt, you see? So you're trying to pull out of it. So you see the what that goes into the family, and then you, and then what do we try to do? We go on a romantic meal, and then you get the credit card, and that just aggravates it. So you got to pay attention what's perpetual and what's solvable.
And see, and this is gold, especially for those who are single, that if you can identify those things, because here's what I will tell you after 20 years of marriage, talking about immediate family, in-laws, you know, whatever. If you are single and you're dating, and you see that her family has some heavy, perpetual issues. The question you need to ask yourself is not whether you're going to fix those issues, because we just learned that you don't fix those issues. Mm-hmm. If the mother-in-law is a little psycho, when you're dating, more than likely, when you marry the guy, and now she's the grandma of your kids, she's just gonna be the psycho grandma, I guess. I don't know, whatever that is. But here's the thing, are you willing to navigate these issues? Because going back to family relationships, what you do is you adapt. Mm-hmm. What you do is you make adjustments. Mm-hmm. What you do is you figure things out. So in this regard, and you used this last night, so I'm gonna take a quote from you. You avoid and you completely disregard using the letter D
right.
in your marriage. Divorce is not an option. It's not an option. Mm-hmm. But you're gonna make the distinction between those two. David closes with us tonight, and just by bringing us the journeying, the finishing up the journey together. What did you mean with that?
There's three peaks in marriage that divorce rate is high. It's at 7 years marriage, high divorce rate. Reasons is you don't fulfill me. You see, you get two self-centered people that don't feel, so they want out. Because first of all, they were delusional about marriage. The second peak of divorce is empty nesters, okay? What happens a lot of times is that husband, wives, they live for their children. That's not biblical. That's not biblical. You see, when people ask us, you know, when my kids left, they go, are you too sad? No. My wife and I, we have a blast because we cultivated our marriage. The kids, we took care of the kids, we taught them the Word of God, we brought them to church, we modeled what it is to be godly. We taught them what it is to love one another, to love God. We were that example. We put them through school. They flew away. And praise God that God is with them. But that doesn't affect my wife and I. You see? So a lot of marriages fall into, you know, like, who are you? The kids are gone. I want to go over here and I want to go over there. They're still living for the children. Big mistake. Big mistake. Our kids, they knew when mommy and daddy is mommy and daddy's time. They didn't come and bother us. Okay? Or we just give them the look. Especially my wife gives that look. And she gives that to me and I'm like, okay. But they understood. The next peak of divorce is retirement. Okay, it's retirement. So how you're nurturing and paying attention to your marriage on a daily basis. So my wife and I, you know, she loves God, I love God. And what's happened is that we've been blessed to go around the world training and pastors and doctors and professionals, surgery, marriage, and other topics together. And, we're gonna finish well. You know, our kids are older, they're not even dating. They're focused on what they need to do. And I may not see my grandchildren. I really don't care. I really don't care if I do or don't. But what I do care about is that my children, when I'm gone, they can see, wow, mom and dad's God was real. I want that God and I want that for my children. That's more important to me than to have a grandchild in my lap that they make it to the kingdom of God. That's what I'm living for. That's the promise of God. And how can I tell people that God is love? They're gonna see the way I treat my wife, the way I love my wife, And you young people here and those that are more seasoned, be that model, be that light for these young people. You want this church to be blessed and more young people come, show them the love of God. And men, we show the love of God the way we love our wives. And they're going to say, wow, there's something real. I want to be part of that.
We began the conversation this morning. The first question had to do with divorce. And you're making me think of the couples that are committed to finish well, but their kids go through divorce. But your grandkids are going through some difficult seasons. And allowing those experiences of either young adult children, and you have some of those, or maybe their children, as a husband and wife, you know, just the concept of being committed to finish together and finish well, regardless of what comes our way. I'm reminded constantly that the scriptures as a whole, the entire Bible, is written primarily, if not exclusively, in times of chaos, mm-hmm. betrayal, desolation, sin, mm-hmm. adultery. And that's exactly the context where we are called to finish well, mm-hmm. finish together. So if you're in this place and you are a person with children, and you wonder, or you may have a child right now that is going through a season, whether it's physically, whether it's emotionally, psychologically, maybe at school, bullying, whatever the case may be, you know, what we do is we give them what they need the most. And what children need the most, I don't care what age they are, is a healthy marriage.
Amen.
So strive for oneness in your marriage for the sake of your children versus the other way around. David, would you please pray for us?